Pastor Bill Evans, Chetwynd Fellowship Baptist Church. We want to get started in our service and welcome you to our time together this morning. It's an exciting morning. And in time, a young dashing rogue will stand up here. And as Glenn said, he's better looking than me. And so that's going to be nice. But we've got David and Anna here from Salmon Arm Country and applying for this job to replace this old face and this old guy here. So I'm delighted. Somebody asked me today, how am I handling it? I'm looking to build my garage and do whatever, have a good time. But right now, we want to lay all that aside and worship the Lord. So we start off with kids' songs, first of all. So we got a couple coming up for the kids, and let's do them. Only a Boy Named David. I'll set my mic down, and you will sing along as we do the action. So big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. Okay, who got older this week?
We all did.
Okay, Ross got older.
Lexi Ann turned 5 on Tuesday.
On Tuesday? Five. She does or did?
Last Tuesday?
Last Tuesday?
Yeah.
Okay, Lexi Ann, good. Well, happy birthday to Lexi Ann. And no one else? Anniversary? Steve and Cindy, did you have a birthday?
We had an anniversary.
You had an anniversary, what day?
Friday,
when was yours? Steve and Cindy? The 5th, April 5th, that's back a ways, okay. And Karen's is mine, it was 42 like you guys. We're coming up Tuesday this week. We'll try to remember that next week, but that's Easter Sunday. So happy Palm Sunday and all those things to you. Whatever. All right, birthdays and anniversaries, let's sing our birthday song for it, and it goes like this. Reminder, born into mom and dad's family, where we get to look like them, and we're born into Jesus' family, we get to act and look like Jesus, and the world sees us that way, so we're glad for that. Okay, we've got a worship team coming now, and the dashing rogue on my left, your right, will be the guy that's going to be preaching later on, so welcome David to this, and Julie and Jim and company to the worship team, thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see so many faces here, and just please stand with us and join as we worship.
It's pretty hard to be better looking than Bill.
First song is Holy is the Lord.
Joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow
you just take a moment to welcome someone here and just say good morning.
The storm that rages, He is Jesus.
I can't imagine other nations in the world, religions of the world, how they sing that sounds anywhere as nice as what we got. You hear chants and different things and whatever, and those words are just, and the words, it's always about the words and whatever. I'm looking there, and you stand with me in the fire. You don't go in the fire. You don't need Jesus standing beside you. But our bulletin says, why blend in when you were born to stand out? And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went in the fire. And then the Son of God was in there with them. So we're challenged with those kind of things, but we're blessed with the gifts that God gives his people and the willingness to use them. And we're looking for that. And Chad, I'm thinking, Sam, beside you, how come you're not up here doing worship somewhere in the future? I'll tell you, Dave, take a look at that face behind you, okay? He sings well and does music well and whatever. So there we are. So we'll pick on you. If you don't want to use your talent, my job as pastor is to pick on. I'm still pastor, and I can throw stuff out there. I was asked, I'm excited. We had time together last night. It was out at Glenn's and Julie's house, and Glenn didn't know how to eat piggy puffs. Does anybody see, who has not tasted piggy puffs? Okay, Dale, you never seen piggy puffs in a little bag and a little pig skin like football? And he's, okay, if you see some, bring some for Glenn, okay, because he needs to taste them. They're really good. We tried to make some last night, and I had them for breakfast this morning once. I brought the whole pigskin home, so I had football for breakfast. It was tasty. And piggy puffs, they're just something. And so I couldn't talk recent having any, but anyhow. Anyhow, we got announcements we have for us here. What's going on this week. We have a prayer meeting Wednesday night, and a week this Thursday being just before Good Friday, a week then we'll have date night started again, and we invited the ladies. We said our first date or steak night, we'll have the ladies there, so we're Lord willing and all things going well, and a week this next Thursday night will be date night, and we'll have hamburgers here and stuff here and have a good time. So that'll be our plan. Other youth stuff is on the back of your bulletin there. What's happening? Anything special, Josh, this week? Nothing special. Okay, well, youth is happening Friday night, special or not, whatever. And whatever, so that's mindful of that and other things in there. If you're visiting with us this morning, sign our guest book. We'd like to have how to say your name and who you are and whatever. So we just got Lizzie and Mitchell just come in here. Welcome, guys. It was part of the shower. The ladies had a wonderful shower back there the other night, and the guys tried to go shooting, and only Kenny and Terry went outside, and everybody was in. Dale had a dot scope that everybody liked shooting with, and nobody went outside to shoot clays. I said, well, how come you didn't go shoot clays? You wanted to, and he didn't drag you out. So if you come back, we'll make that a priority item. Okay. Tomorrow night, we got a business meeting then here at the church at 7, and then we're voting on David and his bride, and then we got to put some committees together for our annual business meeting coming up there. So be mindful of that, and we shall leave those in your hands to be considered of through the week. And if you're not involved in it, please pray for the situation and that the Lord will work out what he wants there. Just a couple of things, prayer requests if you didn't get them. The Manns were pregnant with their third child. And the little one was found, they did an ultrasound on Tuesday or Wednesday and found that the child had, at about 15 weeks, they figured the heart hadn't formed anymore since then, and it passed away. And he phoned me Saturday morning. Friday morning, I was in jail. Okay, you don't see you. Anyhow, I was in jail, and he phoned me at 7 and told me that this little one was found, that had passed, and whatever. And I encouraged them to... Jeremiah 1, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And I also encourage him, I says, name the child, find out what it is and name him. So the little guy's name was Levi Ian, and they're having a little service for him. Those are special things to do. We say we're pro-life. That's life. And we celebrate it. So pray for the mats. He says they're still having some tears, but they'll get through. And they will. Why? God says, I'll walk with you in the fire. I'll walk with you in the fire. So pray for the mans, the family, the guy with the brick to the limestone quarry, rock, we believe was. The tow truck driver said the hole was perfectly square, went through that window. And anyhow, I asked the cops yesterday, is that young man lived or died? And he said, we just got a phone call, said he had passed away. So somebody out of Alberta, Carl from the sports store is talking, some guy phoned him, guy sells Bushnell scopes, and asked him if he'd heard about this accident. And Carl said, no. So he asked the guy standing in front of him, he said, you heard about an accident here? And the guy said, yeah, Serreras, I worked there and was that. And then this guy said, well, his cousin was one involved, but out of Alberta. So pray for that family with that loss and that situation. So anything else particular to pray about right away? Okay, Carol. Okay, this next Thursday. Okay. I guess, yeah, this. Okay, come on. Okay, remember that? Okay, Ross?
Yeah, just pray for my mom, too. She just, over the last few months, she lost a relative to some friends. She'll be turning 90 this August, so it's kind of hard to have that, celebrate that.
She had Ross when she was 20, so do the math. Okay, anything else to pray for?
My neighbor, Tim.
Yeah. And Tim's wife works in Super Valley. Told me, yeah, he's got cancer. I said, is it still testing? She says, no, it's cancer. So pray for those guys there. Okay, remember, let's carry on our surface then now and leave those matters to pray for you to pray with. And we will get you to rise and sing. And our first one today is, you are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words. And we're talking about Christ. And it's such a wonderful. I stand in awe of you. Song, okay, it's so wonderful. Okay, and somebody needs to write a second verse. Here we go again. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your? Of a holy God, and you reached down into time, you made this world, and man fouled it all up, and then to undo the mess, you sent your son Jesus, and he came and he died, and Palm Sunday years ago, it was that first Sunday, the first day of the week, they were gathered together as he rode into Jerusalem, and the kids threw the palms, and the people threw their blankets, and he rode in as a king triumphant. He's going to die on Friday. He's going to be raised from the dead on the following Sunday. All these things we celebrate with our worship on the Lord's Day, as we call it today. But God, we thank you that all this was done so that we could be redeemed by his blood. The wages of sin is death. The gift of God's eternal life. And so God, we stand here this morning because we've received the gift of your Son, Jesus. Your Spirit has opened our eyes to our folly, our losses, our deadness. And God, you've brought us into the body of Christ. And David and Anna come from Salmon Arm, and they fit in like they're just family here, because they are. Friends from Winnipeg come here. Visitors come into town, or other friends from other parts. And they move here. And God, they're the body of Christ. We bless you for that beautiful bride. And your bride gathers today to worship you. To say thank you for who you are. Your great love. Father, we're excited for the days ahead. Young preacher coming to town. And just going to share the gospel. Heart for of love for people. We bless you for what you've done in David and Anna's lives. And we pray, God, that you guide and direct your people. We trust your people to have your Spirit's wisdom for the decision tomorrow evening and all our days ahead. So we bless you for your goodness, your care. We pray, God, for your mercies to attend to those that need you. We pray for the man's as they adjust to this loss. Hold them close and bless them, God. Minister to their hearts, and through this time, oh God, make them be able to minister to others with a comfort, and let them share the comfort that they found with you through this time. God, we ask your grace to be upon them. We pray for this family that lost this young man. Hold them close as they adjust to his passing. Encourage their hearts, oh God. We ask for a protective custody and care upon our community this day and throughout our week. People traveling through and everything, oh God, we just leave our community in your hands, and that your people would be a people of prayer when they hear the ambulance and whatever, pray. And Lord, so many times we've seen you stalled what could have been a bad situation, where people show up and think it's a really bad situation, and you change it around because your people pray. Help us to be mindful to do that. So God, as we worship this morning, meet with us, bless us in this time, receive our thanks for each heart and each home represented here, for Steve and Cindy, their anniversary, and for the 42 years that Karen's put up with me. We just rejoice in these things that we can celebrate, and for the birthdays of Alexia Ann, and we pray your blessing on these. But receive our thanks for this gathering, this time, and hear our prayer and go with us. And Father, for secret problems that we might have, things we can't make public, oh God, draw near and bless us with them. So hear our prayer and bless us in this time, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll be seated, please, and then we will sing our hymn before the message. Oh, Glenn, let's go with the turn the lights on announcements. Keep the lights on announcements. We call these keep the lights on announcements. You got to remind them that we have a new envelope at the back, and with it, there's an email address on it, because many people are using the money is sent to, tapping it to Glenn and whatever. And if you're new at that and whatever, and if you put it into, even if you put money in, still put money in the envelope if that's your thing and whatever. But if you have an email address, it can be sent to the receipt at the end of the year. Then, because I get a stack of envelopes, and I got to trace these people down and run into somebody. Did you know this lady at Mobley? She says, yeah. So can you give her this receipt? Because I have to go find her number and whatever. So that email address on the envelope will help us with that, if you would, please. And that helps keeps our lights on there. We're thankful for that help. But then the prayer requests, and that's more important, is oneprayerchain@gmail.com, and Allie looks after that, and she passes that along and whatever. So just be mindful of those things there, and use them. And the prayer chain, we believe in prayer, and we've seen people get jobs, we've seen whatever. Pray for our hospital. We're still lots of needs there, and there's lots of people in there right now, and whatever. So we'll leave those things in your hands. Any other announcements, any type things for that part? Okay. Let's turn your eyes back to the screen, and we're going to sing "And Can It Be That I Should Gain." It's kind of a question, eh? And can it be that I should gain? Yes, it can be. Sit up straight and sing well.
Yeah.
are talking, everything, Jana, we need to be, remember, we trust that you are praying for the war situation in Ukraine and whatever there, and remembering Jana and her family in the Belarus area there, so just continue to pray for those. Sir David, we've knighted you already, and we throw those titles around freely because it doesn't say in the Bible you can't. You reign in Christ, so get up here, and we'll turn you loose and let you go. You got your own headset? Check, check. We're training Josh on the board there this morning, because next week everybody that runs sound is away, so we'll get them all trained. This is David McMaster. We've had a good visit with him over the weekend here, running around. And
oh, there it is. Nice.
You'll be praying, and see what the Lord does. God bless you, brother, and we'll turn you loose.
Thank you. Well, my name is David. Thanks for having us. I was telling your search committee yesterday that I don't know if I've ever been to a more generous and hospitable church as yours. We've just had such a great time being here. We've been here since Thursday, and Anna got to be a part of that baby shower, and this morning we were trying to play Tetris, trying to figure out how to pack everything into our suitcases. We're pretty full coming here, so... Yeah, true. Yeah, well, we did manage to fit it all in this morning. But yeah, just thank you for having us. We got to tour around the town with Bill and Karen on, I think, Friday morning it was. So it was great getting a feel of your town and getting some of the history on the different neighborhoods and everything. And so, yeah, thank you for hosting us. Thank you for allowing us to worship with you this morning. For those of you who have not met me, I'm David. I've been trying to make some of the rounds, and hopefully I'll be able to meet you at the potluck after. We're from Kelowna currently. We've been helping with a church plant there for the last 2 years with a great friend of mine, and the Lord is doing some incredible things in Kelowna. I've been serving there as the associate pastor for the last 6 months. As the church has become established, we've sort of felt that the Lord was leading us on, and so we've been pursuing different things, and this is why we're here today. Thanks for having us. We are praying for you guys. We're praying that the Lord would give your congregation wisdom and discernment and peace over some of the big decisions you're going to have to make over the next few days. So today, I'm going to preach on something I'm pretty passionate about. And it's helping people understand the gospel, not only intellectually, but how it makes a difference in your life. And even more, what might be holding us back from experiencing the fullness of the gospel. And so I want to move from the gospel has just saved me to the gospel is continually transforming me. A few of my favorite gospel definitions, if you're new to that word, or if you are unfamiliar of how to define it, there's a few. Martin Luther, a reformer of our faith, at its briefest, he said this: the gospel is a discourse about Christ, that he is the Son of God and became man for us, that he died and was raised, and that he has been established as Lord over all things. John Piper, one of my favorite authors and a pastor, he defines it this way: the gospel is the news that Jesus Christ, the righteous one, died for our sins and rose again, eternally triumphant over all his enemies, so that there is now no condemnation for those who believe, but only everlasting joy. And finally, one of my favorite definitions, and it's super simple. And it's from a guy named Tim Keller, who's out of New York. He's a church planter and a pastor. He defines it this way: the gospel is this, that we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. That is one of my favorite definitions. So those are going to be sort of our working definitions as I refer to the gospel. I want to point you to a passage, if you have a Bible today, to Luke chapter 18, verses 10 to 14. And while you do so, while you're flipping there, I want you to consider this. What might be holding you back from experiencing the fullness of God's mercy? And then I want to spend some time at the end looking at how God's mercy changes our lives, how the gospel actually changes our lives. So there's two characters in this story. First, there's a religious Pharisee who follows all of God's rules. Second, there's a tax collector and a sinner. And what I want you to notice is one receives mercy and the other doesn't. So to give you a bit of context, Jesus is well into his earthly ministry. And this is one of the stories he uses to teach. And if you're unfamiliar with a Pharisee, they were a religious group of people often coming up against Jesus, trying to trip him up in his words and catch him in a corner. And it never works because Jesus is God. And so Jesus always has just a great answer and a response to them. So let's pray, and then we'll read the passage together. Father, thank you that we can be here in Chetwynd, praising your name, worshiping you. Holy Spirit, would you come and fill us with wisdom and discernment as we read your word? Would you speak to our hearts? Would you help us to lay aside distractions and Lord, that we would hear your voice spoken through your word as we read it now, Lord. We pray that you would change our lives, that you'd shape us to be more like you, Jesus. We pray this in your name. Amen. Luke 18, verses 10 to 14 says this. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee was standing and praying like this about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like the other people, greedy, unrighteous, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of everything I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even raise his eyes to heaven, but kept striking his chest, saying, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you, this one went down to his house justified rather than the other, because everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. So the Pharisee walks away without receiving mercy, and the tax collector does end up leaving with mercy. And so I have a couple observations in this passage that I want to look at. The first is that the posture of our heart matters to God. And second is that mercy cannot be achieved, but rather it's received. And so I hope that will help us to understand what might be holding us back from receiving the fullness of God's mercy, or what might be distracting us from believing and having the gospel change our lives. So the first thing is that the posture of the heart matters to God. I find it interesting that Jesus uses this story in the context of prayer. I believe that prayer, when we come to God, it exposes the deepest longings of our heart. I don't know what prayer looks like for you. Some of you maybe have the spiritual gift of prayer, and you're prayer warriors, and it's a big part of your life. Some of you maybe only pray when a crisis comes into your life, or maybe when you're angry or sad, or maybe when you're happy. Some of you, maybe it's been a while. But I want to say that prayer is powerful. You have the privilege of coming to the King of the universe where you're able to pour out your heart in true vulnerability. And the beautiful thing is that God listens. Prayer is an opportunity to be honest before God, and I think that's what he's looking for. And he knows what you're going through, whatever you're going through. Now notice the difference between the two prayers. They're both praying to God. The Pharisee says, God, I thank you I'm not like the people, greedy, unrighteous, adulterous, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of everything I get. On the surface, he actually sounds like a pretty good Christian. Like if you're setting standards for Christians and you meet someone and that's them, you'd think, okay, that's actually a pretty good Christian. He's doing the right things. But the problem is the posture of his heart is all wrong. And we'll get to that in a bit. On the other side, though, we have the tax collector. And his prayer is, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. This man went away justified in his prayer. He received mercy, yet he's a sinner. Worse yet, he's a tax collector. And tax collectors back then were very despised by people. They were despised by their own people. They were often corrupt and greedy and selfish. And yet he goes away justified. He goes away having received mercy. Why? Because I think the posture of his heart was that God was his only hope. He didn't have any other option. The only thing he could hope in was that God would have mercy on him. And he was honest in his prayer before God. Think about it for a second. The difference between these two people is not that one was righteous and one was a sinner. They're both sinners. The difference was that the tax collector acknowledged the fact that he was a sinner and he repented before God about his sin. He was honest about God in his prayer. So consider this in your own life. At the deepest core of your soul, what do you believe about who you are? How do you come to God in prayer? What is the posture of your heart? Do you relate more with the Pharisee or with the tax collector? The Pharisee says, "Lord, look at what I've done for you. This is what I deserve." Or, "Lord, I've given money to you. I deserve a return. Lord, I've helped the poor this week. I deserve your blessing. Lord, I'm not greedy or unrighteous or adulterous. Lord, here's what I've done and here's what I deserve." Yet it says at the end of that passage, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. What the Pharisee is looking for is God to affirm him, not forgive him. And that's a dangerous place, I think, for us to be in. He's assuming that being a good person, having everything look good on the outside, is going to be the thing that saves him. But God sees right through it. He sees right to the heart. On the other hand, maybe you relate more with the tax collector, the sinner. "Lord, I messed up this week." Or, "Lord, I was greedy this week." Or, "Lord, I was selfish this week. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." What the tax collector is looking for is mercy, because he knows he doesn't deserve it. And then God gives him that mercy. He's not trying to earn it because he knows he can't. And so the posture of your heart before God matters. And either your prayer will tell how great God is, or it will tell how great you are. And when we humble ourselves before God, that's when we're going to receive mercy. So the posture of the heart matters. Second thing is that God's mercy is not achieved, but rather it's received. The tax collector understood the gospel whether he realized it or not. All the scripture points to the fact that we are sinful people in desperate need of a savior, and that no effort of our own can save us. The whole Old Testament, there's a list of rules and stuff, and all that did was show us where we missed the mark. Jesus, on the other hand, doesn't. He doesn't miss the mark. He lived that perfect, that sinless life that we could never do. And then he went on the cross to die and resurrect, something that we celebrate at Easter and Good Friday. And so salvation is an undeserved gift, but it's purchased at a cost. It's at the expense of Jesus' life. But think about the Pharisee for a moment. He didn't get it. He didn't want the gift. He wanted the good deeds. He wanted his life to be what got him to heaven. It would be like waking up on Christmas morning and having received some presents or something from your parents, and then after opening up all your gifts, going and paying them back for it all. That's not how giving works. Gifts are free, but it's always at the cost of the gift giver. So God freely gives his life so that you could have the gift of life. You cannot earn it. You cannot achieve it. You cannot buy it. You can only receive it by grace alone, through faith alone. So those are the two observations. The posture of your heart matters before God, and that mercy cannot be achieved, but rather it is received as a free gift from God. Now I want to come back to that question. What holds us back from experiencing the fullness of God's mercy, or even the fullness of the gospel in our lives? And I think there's two primary opponents of the gospel that are found within Christianity. And the Pharisee gives us a great picture of one of them, and then there's a second one that is a little bit in that one. And so the first opponent is religion. The second is irreligion, and both have the tendency to lead us away. They're kind of on different ends of the spectrum. And I would argue that we all sort of have a natural bent to one or the other, depending on how we were raised, in what generation, and what we've been taught. And so the religious person, this one's obvious because it's the character we've been looking at. It's the Pharisee. The religious tend to think they're better than others. They tend to brag about how great they are. They tend to check off a list of things they've done or things they haven't done. What bothers a religious person, though, is when someone who maybe isn't the perfect picture Christian receives mercy and grace from God, even though they don't deserve it. And here's the core belief of a religious person. If I do all these things for God, he will love and accept me. Instead of the opposite, which is Jesus loves and accepts me, therefore out of the gratitude and out of the worship of my heart, I will do those things. The order matters. The motivation of the heart matters. The motive has to be out of what Christ has done for you and not what you've been done for Christ. So the sin is achieving salvation. It's achieving mercy. And so that's opposition number one, the religious person. Now, on the other hand, there's the irreligious person. Now, this is a little less obvious in the character, but it's much more common in our current culture. Especially with younger generations, this sort of thinking is pretty popular. And it's this idea of postmodern thinking, which says what's true for you might not be true for me. Or that truth is relative. I can decide what I want truth to be, and it might be different from you. But we know that doesn't work. Irreligion in Christianity is this idea that Jesus is my free ticket to heaven, and I can do and I can live however I want because Jesus will affirm everything I believe. The irreligious tend to say God is only loving, that we can do whatever we want because Jesus will just affirm whatever we believe. They tend to think of Scripture more as a suggestion. They tend to deny absolute truth, therefore affirming sinful actions and yet believing it's right. The problem, and this is where it relates to the Pharisee in the passage, is the irreligious person is not looking for grace or mercy. They're looking for God to affirm them in their action and their beliefs. That's what the Pharisee wanted to. To revisit one of our gospel definitions, they don't believe that they're more sinfully flawed than they ever dared believe. And so the root problem, it's a misunderstanding of the gospel. It's a misunderstanding of God's mercy. It's saying, who cares what it costs Jesus his life if it means I can live however I want? And what they don't understand is that God does have boundaries that we are to live in. Before I got my license, I felt like I didn't really have a whole lot of freedom. I couldn't drive anywhere I wanted. I kind of lived out of town, and so I was pretty much stuck and bound by whoever would drive me around. But as soon as I got my driver's license, all of a sudden, I felt like I had freedom, like absolute freedom. I could go anywhere I wanted, anytime I wanted, as long as I had a vehicle. And it was great. But really, I didn't have absolute freedom because there's still rules I had to follow with the law. I couldn't go over certain speed limits. I'd have to wear a seatbelt. There's all these things that are in place to protect us. And if you don't, there's consequences to that. And so the freedom is not absolute, but we do have freedom to live how God has called us to live, which is a better way of living. His way that he teaches us to live in Scripture is the best way to live. And so the irreligious person, rather than receiving grace, they tend to abuse grace. They want God to affirm them, and the motivation of the heart, again, is wrong, which is the root sin of the Pharisee. So those are the two sort of opposite ends of the spectrum on the things that come against the gospel. The religious and the irreligious. The religion says, I don't need you. Irreligion says, I'll take you, but I don't really care about you. Religion says, you must obey rules. Irreligion says, rules don't apply to me. Religion is hyper-truth. Irreligion is hyper-grace. Religious people say, obeying rules will make God love you. The irreligious are saying, don't obey rules because God already does love you. So then what do we do with that? What is the right answer in that case? Well, there's a third way, and it's a gospel approach. And I think it's the posture of the tax collector. And it's this, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner, because there is nothing I can do to earn it. It is saying, I don't want to achieve salvation through following rules because it's already been achieved for me. Rather, out of the gratitude of being given salvation, I want to live and I want to seek to live the way that God has called us to live. It is by receiving, not achieving, and not abusing. And so the gospel approach is a response to salvation. It is out of worship. It is out of a joyful heart because Jesus has rescued you. It comes down to your posture before God. Is it, Lord, look how great I am? Or is it, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner? And those questions, I believe, will change everything about your life. Everything you, the way you approach life. So how does it change the different ways, areas of your life? Here's some practical examples. I'm going to list just three for now. Some which have I've boiled down from some reading I've done. One coming from Center Church, which is a great book I read on church planting. And he talked a lot about this stuff. And so here's one. When it comes to love and relationships, I think with God and with other people, the religious Pharisee tends to say you need to earn love. The irreligious tends to say, I will love as long as it doesn't cost me anything. The gospel approach says you can love because you've already been fully loved by God. You don't need to earn love because God has already fully loved you. Therefore, you don't need to strive for that acceptance. You don't need to strive to impress because God already loves you as you are. Even if it doesn't benefit, you can love others too. How about discouragement? The religious Pharisee says, you're discouraged because you're not following God's rules. Therefore, discouragement is a behavioral problem. The irreligious person, on the other hand, says, you're discouraged. You must just love and accept yourself. Therefore, discouragement is more of an emotional problem. The gospel says, actually, no, both of those are wrong. Discouragement is when you put your faith and your trust in something that isn't God, and that thing has let you down. And it's actually a heart problem. And the key to combating discouragement is centering your heart on Jesus as your Savior and as your satisfaction. The third one we're going to look at is evangelism. The religious person will often come to evangelism, coming to people and saying, we are right, you are wrong, so believe in Jesus. The irreligious person tends to come to it saying, challenging the legitimacy of it altogether because it might be true for you, but it's not true for me, and so it just doesn't work. The gospel gives a better way. It says, share how the gospel has changed your life. The gospel is personal and it's transformative. And I think the best way to show Jesus, it's through the work that Jesus has done in your own life. People, I don't think, just want to hear about Jesus. They want to see Jesus. And I hear this all the time. I think the best Bible, the only Bible some people might read is your life. So show them how Jesus has transformed your life. The transforming power of the gospel gives us a new framework for life, and these can be applied to basically anything. And so our call is to be a people who are willing to approach God like the tax collector with honesty, with vulnerability, with repentance, understanding that we are more sinful than we ever dared believe, but yet we are more accepted in Christ than we ever dared hope. But here's what we need to remember again. The posture of the heart matters, and that God's mercy cannot be achieved, but rather it's received. So what might be holding you back from the fullness of God's mercy? Maybe for some of you, today is the day to be honest before God. Maybe you have a tendency to be more on the religious side, on following rules, and that's become your salvation. Maybe you pride yourself on how great of a Christian you are. Don't let that distract you from understanding that you are just as sinful as everyone else in the room, that you are in just as need as mercy as everyone else in the room. Maybe others of you, you've sort of believed, well, Jesus saved me, now I can live however I want. I can do whatever I want. And I would ask, have you actually experienced mercy? Because I think the natural response is gratitude and worship when you've received mercy, not a license to abuse grace. Maybe others of you are saying, I'm too bad to experience mercy. God would never save me if he knew the things that I have done. And here's what I would say. You're never too far gone from grace. You're never too far from God's mercy. God's goodness, and he's greater than any sin that you've ever committed. The sinful tax collector received mercy. You can receive mercy today too. You can be forgiven, freed from sin and guilt. You can leave with a new identity as children of God, beloved by God. And when you receive that mercy, it changes everything about your life. But I think, again, it begins by understanding the posture of your heart matters before God, that salvation is not achieved or received, but rather received. And so here's my vision for a church. I would love for you to continually experience the transforming power of the gospel in every area of your life. I want you to know who you are in Christ. I want you to know that you are never too far away from the mercy of God. You're never too far gone. I want to see you all continually become more like Christ. I want to help you reach your neighbors, your unsaved friends and family members through the impact of the gospel in your own life. Let's go today in with the heart of the tax collector saying, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Let us go as people forgiven and freed and worship God with our forgiven lives. I want to end again with that gospel definition from Keller, who said, we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we're more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. Do you believe that today, church? Let's pray. Father, thank you that you sent Jesus to save sinners like us. Lord, we don't deserve your mercy, but I thank you through the sacrifice of your life on the cross, through your death and your resurrection, that we are saved. Lord, would you continually shape our hearts that we would become more like you? Would you lead us away from religious or irreligious tendencies, but rather be a people shaped by the transforming power of your gospel? I pray that you would help us to reflect Jesus through our lives. Would we be a testament to your mercy and your grace that you have given us? Lord, we thank you, we love you, we honor you, and we praise you with our lives and with our worship today. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Sir David. If your heart wasn't blessed, you got issues. Can we find, please, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less, please, for our closing hymn. And we'll get you to stand and sing with us, and then Glenn will dismiss us in prayer. Glenn and Julie are going away on a well-deserved holiday, leaving Friday, and be gone for a week, I think. So pray for them as they're doing whatever. Glenn has been here 2 years, all through that pandemic time and whatever, and he's not been gone very long. So just pray for them, give them a good holiday, that God will bless them. We're thankful for their part in our church family, and we had a great supper there last night and good time. So My Hope is Built on Nothing Else. Is that coming up?
The Solid Rock.
The Solid Rock is the title, sorry. I'm techie enough, I just tell Google, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. They tell me what the song is. What's the matter, you techies? What's the matter? What's that? 443. That work? On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand. Who's singing without the music? Whatever the words we have to. Not there? My Hope is Built on Nothing. That's not in our hymn book. Okay, I'm resigning. It's gone.
It's a line from a song called Cornerstone.
Which one? I'm resigning? My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. We've sang that. Did you find it? Just choose one then. So what's a hymn that's like that? And we don't know. Nothing down there for my hope is built. Nothing. The solid rock on Christ, the solid rock. It's on. Did you try on Christ, the solid rock? This is fun. You people at home enjoying us? You said it's number 444 is not in there. Okay. 443. What's that one? You get the hymn book in front of you. Just tell us. Is it number 443? It's not there, guys. So let's just choose a different one. Let's sing. You found it or you didn't? Okay, we have it. Here we go. Just go live. There we are. Good. Take over the sound, guys. Glenn will dismiss us in prayer after we sing. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant, his blood to show a point in the whelming flood, in every heart. It's jumping around here. Let's sing verse 4. When he shall come with trumpet sound. And David, this is rare because we never skip verses of him. Let's get verse 4. When he shall come with trumpet sound. And we'll close off with Glenn. Let's do that. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Rest in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Little lesson, David, you'll learn if you're here, is that the devil always tries to stop the service. And he'll throw little things in there. That's a good message. And he wants to be distracted from the idea that on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. If you don't know that message this morning, don't leave without talking to myself, talking to David, talking to one of the Christian friends you have in the church. It's important you know that if you died today and you don't know Jesus, you're in trouble. So you got to know him. And so just be mindful of that. And he puts you on a solid rock when all of what's that quicksand in the world and all the traps of the world and the devil, and he saves you from those things. So let's just say Glenda dismisses in prayer, and we'll carry on. Say goodbye if you're not staying for lunch, and if you're staying for lunch, God bless you. We'll have some food. Thank you, Glenn.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning and the chance to worship with our church family, and it we don't take that for granted anymore, Lord. Yes, we just praise you for that. We thank you for the message this morning of grace, of the gospel, that it's not about religion or irreligion, it's about Jesus. And we just pray that that truth would become alive in us this week. We just thank you for speaking through David. We thank you for him and Anna and little Adeline, and we just praise you for bringing them here for this weekend, that we could have some fun with them and just see who they are and learn about them. So we just pray that you would guide and direct just the decisions, things we have before us now, and we just thank you that we can fellowship today with a potluck lunch afterwards. So we just ask for your blessing on that and the rest of this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. We have a rule around here for newbies. You're not supposed to leave without shaking my hand. So the back door.